Hi, I'm Dr. Michael Carr-Gregg. I've been asked by Education Queensland to run a series of workshops around the state to help parents and teachers work together to boost the well-being and learning of young people. Today we're going to do a crash course in the developmental psychology of adolescence. Now, adolescence has changed dramatically over the last couple of years. First of all, in 1901, the average age in which a young woman, for example, had a first period was 16 years of age. Today, it's a staggering 10.2. This means that the stages of adolescent development are completely out of sync. Add to that the social toxins of Facebook, YouTube, the technology, an extraordinarily heavy burden with parents divorcing and separating, and adolescence is tougher now than ever before. One of the things that we understand is that something fundamental has changed in their support system. A couple of years ago, someone asked the young people in a girls' magazine, who are your most important allies? And the response 10 years ago was, well, as a matter of fact, it's my parents. Today, when we ask that same question, parents have been relegated to second position. The first are their peers. This is the most tribal generation of young people we've ever seen. One of the interesting things is that many, many kids, when they're asked, do you feel safe, valued, and listened to, will actually answer yes to safe, sometimes to valued, and unfortunately, over 75% of them say, well, actually, we don't feel like we're being listened to. So communication is absolutely critical in working with adolescents effectively. So what we first have to understand is that adolescents come in three delicious flavours. The first flavour is what we call early adolescence. And this is a time when they've hit puberty and they're asking themselves a question. And the question is, am I normal? Now, in order for us to be effective communicators with the early adolescent, everything that we do has to go to reassure them that they are normal. So even if they've got two heads, what we say to them is, well, for a two-headed person, you're very, very normal. All our communications should be basically about affirming them in their normality. Now, early adolescence is preceded by a very interesting phase, middle adolescence. And in middle adolescence, the question is a different one altogether. It's no longer, am I normal? It's, who am I? And the key question has to be answered through healthy, appropriate, risk-taking behaviour. The more we involve the middle adolescent in art, music, sport, dance, drama, in healthy risk-taking, the easier it will be for them to be able to define themselves. One of the worst enemies of a middle adolescent is, in fact, boredom. If kids are bored, have nothing to stimulate them, they will actually end up doing things which probably won't be in their best interests long term. So the final stage of adolescence is late adolescence. This is a time when the peers become less important and they kind of feel a bit closer to their parents, primarily because they need their parents' money, food, car, and financial assistance long term. But the interesting thing about these kids is their question is no longer, am I normal or who am I? The question is, where am I going? And a lot of people make the assumption that these kids know the answer to that question. Whereas in fact, the research shows that it is at this time that they need an adult person in their lives to help them develop strategies and goals to achieve where it is that they want to go. So there you have it, the three stages of adolescence. Now, the implications of this for communication are profound. At no other time in their life is the sensitivity to control as strong. So the number one rule in communicating with teenagers is to use language that doesn't trigger their sensitivity to control. So for example, you wouldn't say to a young person, go and do the dishes. What you would do is you'd say, when in the next half hour would you like to do the dishes? The dishes may well not actually get done when you want them, but in fact they will eventually get done. The other really important component of this is consequential learning. There is a behaviour economy in adolescence. Most of them will weigh up between should I do this and should I not do this, and base it on the previous experiences they've had. So if we have articulated up front what our attitudes and beliefs are, and we've made it very clear to them what the consequences are, then they will have to make that choice in the full knowledge that if they do one thing, there will be a consistent response from the parents every single time. This is, of course, regarded as authoritative parenting and is one of the most valuable tools going around. What we do know is that yelling, shouting, and screaming at young people is fundamentally ineffective. And it's ineffective primarily because they're operating off a part of their brain called the amygdala. Now, this is a very primitive reptilian part of the brain, which doesn't do a lot of thinking, but it does a lot of responding. So what we have to recognize is it's much better to stay calm, to use language that doesn't trigger their control, and to wait till they've calmed down. Remember, the teenage brain is only going to be fully formed at 23 years of age in girls, and on a good day, with the wind behind you, 27 in boys. So I think we can end this discussion with a clear understanding that there are three stages of adolescence, that we have to use a different form of communication with them, and that the number one issue is to try and find a negotiation or a compromise rather than have a confrontation up front. Remember, there's no such thing as a perfect parent. We all just try to do the best that we can.